Hello, everyone. I hope you can hear me. This is Jan from the English Bookshop again. So this is will be our third author talk today, and things are going pretty well, actually, I think. And for this talk, we're very proud to have Jasper Fforde joining us, and he'll be talking to Linnéa Anglemark, who's a great friend of the Bookshop. Don't forget to fill in the form to get a signed copy of Jasper's book. We have sent him book plates all the way over the North Sea. And after the talk, he will be able to sign these book plates and send them back to us. And we'll put them in his book and pass it on to you in one way or another. So do take that opportunity. What else? Yes, we're not charging anything for any of these talks today, but there's a donate option with Swish or PayPal if you feel like supporting the work we do in the Bookshop. And so the talk now will be first Jasper. Hello, Jasper. Reading and then Jasper talking to Linnéa for about half an hour. And you can put your questions into the live chat and we'll get to them after that half hour talk. And then after the whole thing is done, there will be a special coffee clutch link where you can join Jasper and Linnéa in a separate room to just chat. All right, that's all the particulars, I think. So I, for one, am very curious. Jasper, what will you be reading?
Right. Hello. I understand you've got very bad weather at the moment there. We have too, so it's not just you guys. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read from my latest book, which is called The Constant Rabbit. To give you a little bit of a sort of idea about it's a sort of slightly absurd allegorical novel of which the conceit is that in 1968, 18 rabbits underwent this anomalous anthropomorphizing event and suddenly became 6 foot tall. They could talk, they could walk, they had reason, they could understand about their place within society, and they like to do human things. They drive cars, you know, and all these sort of things. But of course, they're very rabbity as well. So it's now 2022, so it's a good 55 years later, and their numbers have grown a bit, and there's almost a million of them now, and they live in the UK. And initially, when they arrived, it was, well, this is amazing, welcome, you know, celebration. But as their numbers grew, this has sort of grown to a bit of fear and trepidation, and eventually hatred, and they find themselves the demonized minority other in a sort of slightly post Brexit UK. So no satire here, as you can see at all. So I'm going to read, just to give you, that's an idea of the conceit of the book. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read a little section here, and this is about a place called Ross-on-Wye. Ross-on-Wye is a kind of rabbit-free town. It's where rabbits can actually live in the town, and this was due to an integration experiment many, many years ago. So it's a bit of a thorn in the government side, because this is sort of free movement for rabbits. And anyway, but I'll read a little section from this. There's no other notes, I think. Oh yeah, except that a fud, as in Elmer Fudd, is a rabbit slang for a human, right? It's a slightly pejorative term for a human, is a fud. So I'll read this. The Ross integration experiment, while hugely successful at the time and still regarded as the gold standard for peaceful interspecies coexistence, was never rolled out further due to a concerted smear campaign by the United Kingdom Anti-Rabbit Party, who despised the concept of integration and instigated numerous complaints about the rabbit's, quote, bacchanalian nature of rampant promiscuity that would surely corrupt the nation's youth. Despite no evidence that the nation's youth needed any outside forces to help corrupt itself in the least, UKARP, that's what they're called, United Kingdom Anti-Rabbit Party, succeeded in casting doubt over further integration and were as surprised as anyone when their plan succeeded. They used it as a springboard to further pursue their anti-rabbit agenda. No one could have foreseen that it would actually lead the nation four decades later. Before Ross, we had only failure, said a spokesman for UCARP. Afterwards, only success. Despite the leporophobic rhetoric, leporophobic is fear of rabbits, obviously. Despite the leporophobic rhetoric, the once sleepy market town of Ross was now a bustling centre of commerce, which encompassed trade, crafts, literary and artistic pursuits, as well as two centres for higher learning that revolved around philosophy, high cuisine and sustainability. While a few residents initially complained about the rabbits, all won over by the vibrant nightlife, friendly, upbeat manner of the newcomers, and of course, the trading opportunities. Although rabbits were not paid well, they liked to spend it quickly. The gourmet lettuce bars did particularly well, as did the numerous greengrocers, a thriving bookstore, and several hookah dens where rabbits discussed politics, economics, and carrot hybridization issues, while their hookahs bubbled and puffed with the aromatic scent of a variety of rabbit tobacco, dock leaf, catnip, burdock, celeriac, and dandelion. More relevant to the Rabbit Compliance Task Force, that's the task force in the UK, which is, well, the Rabbit Compliance Task Force, speaks for itself. Ross was by local statute an open town, both commercially, residentially, and crucially, those on a day permit from Rabbit Colony 1, 8 miles to the east. Due to a well-intentioned bylaw passed 40 years before, busloads of rabbits could move between the two locations without identification checks, something of a headache for the Rabbit Compliance Task Force, as it made free movement that much easier. Lugless spoke on the radio to make sure the units were in position, then dug a carrot out of a brown paper bag and crunched on it noisily. I should have said here that my protagonist, Peter Knox, is actually on ops in Ross, and they're looking for what they think is a dodgy rabbit who might be working for the rabbit underground. And Lugless is his next in command, who happens to be a rabbit with no ears. Lugless spoke on the radio to make sure the units were in position, then dug a carrot out of a brown paper bag and crunched on it noisily. "So," I said, trying to ignore the carrot crunching, "you're a AA002. "Yep," said Lugless, neither wanting nor expecting to expand upon the subject. Since he carried the alphanumeric surname, he would be descended from the three laboratory rabbits anthropomorphized at the event. The DG6721s were the most numerous, with the MNU683s not far behind. They all suffered ongoing health issues due to experimentation pre-event, aside from the AA002s, who to their constant shame had been a control rabbit in the lab and subjected to no tests at all, something that gave them a huge residual guilt that often manifests itself in antisocial behaviour. That in itself wasn't enough to have Lugless cropped. Lugless must have been doing something seriously unpleasant, either improper sexual conduct or doing what he was doing now. Rabbits despised a collaborator as much as they despised those who extracted favours by coercion. We sat for another 5 minutes in silence. "Am I here on some sort of test?" I asked. "I don't know," said Lugless without looking up. "Are you?" "I was on the Dylan rabbit arrest detail," I said. "The senior group leader wanted me to concur on an ID and I wasn't sure, but is there a point to this story?" asked Lugless, because you're getting kind of whiny in that uniquely human way. "I guess not," I said, "but an innocent rabbit was jugged. And look," said Lugless, "there are no innocent rabbits. There are simply those who have drifted into criminality and those that will. You heard Wiesel and Fleming. There is an extremely good chance that the rabbit community might be planning to kick off a litter bombing campaign that will outnumber FUDs in this green and pleasant land by at least 3-1 in under 5 years. Do you want to be outnumbered in your own country?" "Well, no, obviously." "Right then," said Lugless. "So why don't you shut your trap and leave broad strategy to Nigel Smedic and the senior group leader?" I fell silent. The notion of reproductive weaponization had been the pet conspiracy theory of UCARP for over four decades. But given the rabbits had been here 55 years and barely numbered a million, commendable restraint would be a more realistic appraisal of their reproductive habits. And there you have it, a little section from The Constant Rabbit.
Thank you. I've been sitting here smiling while I was listening. I've literally just read this book, or well, week ago or so I finished it. And to be honest, I've taken this interview as an excuse to reread several of your novels, but this is this most recent one I read. And so, how long have you been thinking about the rabbit novel? It's obviously very sort of topical and current. How long were you working on it for? And
I think the germ of the idea began in about I was writing another book called Early Riser, a thriller set in a world in which humans have always hibernated. And I was having a lot of trouble writing that. And there was at one point where I just, for about a month, I just said, right, I'm going to do something else. And I got this idea for rabbits moving into the neighborhood, and everyone doesn't like rabbits because they're rabbits, and that was a good reason. And I started writing it, and I fell in love with the idea. And I just put down about 25,000 words. And it sort of made sense to me. I kind of liked the idea of it as writing and sort of an allegory, about otherism and just how you would dislike rabbits if they were like sort of human like. And after I'd finished Early Riser, I got back to Constant Rabbit, and it was finished about a year and a half ago, I think. So it was also sort of timed, I think, really with the whole Brexit thing going on in the UK as well, and all the nonsense and sort of fibs that were being told around Brexit, which to my personal view, is kind of more about sort of xenophobia, racism, and this rather bizarre desire for the British to sort of hang on to empire in some way and to look backwards rather than forwards. And all that is kind of reflected in the book. It's kind of a bit of a wake up call for me as British, but I think it was important to write.
So did things happen while you were writing? I mean, things in the outside world, in politics, that made their way into the book that you didn't know about when you started plotting out the story?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, my regret is that I didn't put more in. I think I should have put more in and brought more real life characters into it, just to make it even more sort of more incisive. But a lot that was going on, I think, and I was doing a lot of reading as well. I was doing a lot of, because I'm, you know, as you can see, I'm completely white. So writing a book that is about being part of, you know, about being a minority other. And being a demonized minority, other, obviously I have no experience from that. So I'm very much telling it from the story, from the viewpoint of someone who doesn't realize this. You know, my character, Peter Knox, is very, very complicit in a very, very unpleasant regime. And he doesn't know it. He has no idea that he's complicit. He thinks he's a nice guy. And so I was thinking about or questioning all sorts of things that I've done and things in the past. And the attitudes that I've had, and then I'm obviously doing a lot of reading as well, and then sort of all of it seemed to come together in a quite interesting way. So it was quite an interesting journey, because when you start writing about stuff, you question things. Obviously, all authors question things. Whatever you're writing, you're always going to put a bit of politics in it, and I think that's good.
Yes, I mean the Peter Knox, he's. He thinks he's a good guy, and he seems like a sympathetic guy in some ways, but he's relatable in frightening ways, I would say.
Yeah. I mean, he is a nice guy. I mean, he's not a bad person, you know. And this I think is one of the, you know, the major planks of the book, is that you can be a nice person and have very, very small sort of aberrant viewpoints, which, you know, are not big in themselves, but when there's tens of millions of you, of course they make life very difficult for other people. So it's totally possible to be a very nice guy and to have just very a way of looking at things, a way of looking at an issue that in itself personally on your own is not a huge deal, but obviously when it's added up to all the millions and millions of people who look like me and have acted like me in the past, and maybe are still acting now, then it has an effect. It has obviously a huge, huge effect. So that was kind of why I liked to have him. He's kind of, he's a little bit spineless, but he is kind of nice. But he thinks that he's one of the good guys because he's not one of the extreme people with an extreme opinion. So he thinks he's one of the good guys, but you can, you know, you can be one of the good guys and still not be 100% there.
Right. So, I mean, and I guess that's part of why he is a nice person and he's redeemable in a way that his, I mean, his doesn't, he questions his own.
Yeah, I think he is redeemable. And I think, I think that's good because I think everybody is almost everybody is redeemable unless someone is suffering some severe sort of personality disorder. You know, that they are redeemable, I think, in some way. He's not a bad person. He's just been brought up in a certain way. You know, I think that's it. And he's working, he's doing a horrible job. I mean, he's working for the Rabbit Compliance Task Force. So he's doing, you know, an awful job. He's doing terrible things. But he just says, well, if I didn't do it, you know, someone else would. You know, it's, hey, no biggie, but it is a biggie.
Even though you're writing about these very, very dark, sort of grim, disquieting topics, it's still a book that has its share of silliness, which is something that comes back in all your books. And well, there's a lot of inventiveness. That's something that really strikes me as a reader of your books. But I wonder if I think I read somewhere that when you started writing The Air Affair, which was the first book I have it in front of me, back in which was published in 2001. Then that started as the question, what would happen if Jane Eyre was kidnapped or was sort of removed from her story? So that sort of started from that idea, the sort of plot element. It sounds like this started more from a setting or a sort of reaction to what life looks like around us. Am I making sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, the interesting thing, I mean, The Air Affair, for anyone who hasn't read it, this is a book set in 1985 in a sort of parallel world in which people love literature, and they love literature, you know. And there is a literary detective whose name is Thursday Next, and someone kidnapped Jane Eyre out of the original manuscript of Jane Eyre, and it's blank. Everybody's copy of the book all around the world is blank from 200, page 200 onwards. And Thursday has to find how Jane Eyre was kidnapped and get her back into the book. And that's basically the conceit. It was basically, I mean, that was my idea. I write by this thing that I call a narrative dare. Right? So I set myself a narrative dare. Jane Eyre is kidnapped and must get her back. Rabbits live amongst us. They're not much like to deal with it. Write a thriller set in a world in which humans always hibernated. I've done nursery rhymes as police procedural. So I sort of put this kind of narrative there, and then I sort of put it in my own little way. And they're always, all my books, I write sort of, they're kind of serious, they're kind of silly at the same time. I do like absurdity. I do like, obviously, to entertain. I do like to make people laugh. And whilst, you know, we've been talking about The Constant Rabbit, and it's like, ooh, this is a bit of a serious book. And there's a lot of very, very silly stuff in it as well. Rabbits are great fun. They have a very, very bizarre way of living, and they're very funny. I mean, they are very, very funny. And all the situations that people get into, it's almost like, you know, sort of a sort of silly farce, you know, like a bedroom farce. Quick, my husband, get in the cupboard. You know, what do you mean get in the cupboard? It's my house. Okay, well, I'll get in the cupboard, you know, and take out a book and a light and start reading the book. And you go, she's probably done quite a lot, you know. And it's this kind of ongoing silliness, which I like, and absurdity. And it takes away, perhaps, from making it a serious, serious book. But the, you know, when you write allegory, you can do almost kind of critical comment kind of under the radar in a sort of way, because you don't know, it's just a silly book. But with The Air Affair, going back to what I was saying there, is that I, having grown up in a very academic family, but not being academic myself, and spent a great deal of my time, perhaps too much, being very suspicious of academics. And when it came to the classics, I was kind of feeling that I wanted to have fun with the classics and be, as I call it, sort of reverently irreverent, if that makes sense. And to reclaim the classics from being dusty study texts that you only read at school or university. And, you know, let's have fun with Jane Eyre. It's a great book. You know, let's meet Rochester. Let's, you know, why did Thornfield Hall burn down? You know, what started the fire? There's something going on, you know, in the back of the book, and we can learn about that. But also, there's lots going on about some Thursday and her life, and, you know, and her partner and her boyfriend and everything getting together, and what the world is like in 1985 and everything. So there's a lot going on, and I like being inventive for it.
Yes, there's always a lot going on in your books, and I find myself wondering sometimes when I read your books, how do you? I'm not going to ask you where you get your ideas from, but how do you keep track of them? Because I mean, all of a sudden, you introduce spoons with engraved postcodes, and they make perfect sense in the story. But I mean, I wonder, at the sort of meta level, do you come up with those ideas and write them down and then add them to or introduce them to a story where they work a year, 5 years later? Or how does this work?
Yeah, it's ideas are interesting. I think one of the things I could always do was, you know, invent silly stuff, and I had to learn to write to be able to make sense of this thing that I can do. But ideas beget other ideas. When you start off, this is why I never plan a book. I never plan a book. And I start off with one idea, and all of a sudden, because books have to have an internal logical framework that makes sense. Now, if you were to, you were talking from the book I wrote called Shades of Grey. And Shades of Grey, if I try and pricey it, it's a post-apocalyptic, long post-apocalyptic dystopia novel, and it centers around a social order based on the colors that you can see. And that's basically it. And it's like, well, that's a bit weird. But when you start going down that rabbit hole, then the logic of the world, suddenly you start asking yourself questions. Well, let's have this immovable sort of script that these people have to adhere to within this world of you know, seeing colours or not seeing colours. And one of the rules was that one of the rules that got left out was that you couldn't make any more spoons. Now, I kind of like this idea, because when you have immovable, either whether they're a nation's constitution or they're a book of rules, whether they follow religiously or whatever, they can be taken very literally. So I was thinking, okay, well, why don't we take that idea to a literal sort of end? And in this book, it's not specifically stated that you can't make spoons. Right? Someone left them out of the list. You can make knives, you can make forks, but they left spoons off the list. It's a mistake in the book. Right? That's what it is. That's all it is, a mistake. And my readers will know instantly that this is just a mistake. But the people who are following these scripture, this immovable scripture, are saying, right, well, we can't have spoons, so what are we going to do? And then you're taking this idea to the logical sort of conclusion. And, you know, who gets the spoon? You know, who gets the family spoon? Because after 100 years of no spoons, they're going to be pretty rare. And you're going to have, like, the spoon, family spoon, pointing out the eldest son or daughter. And how would you feel if your eldest brother or eldest sister got the spoon that you've got right in yours, and then they have their postcodes on them, and then you're talking about postcode losses, because we have, I don't know what it's like with you guys. But here, you know, you can pretty much, you know, describe someone just by their postcode, by where they live. And I thought that was another interesting sort of little aside to put in the book. So it's basically ideas without other ideas, but it's all to fit within the logical framework of this absurd world that I create. And because readers are so brilliant and fantasy readers are so brilliant. They understand the logical framework of thought as well. And of course, the spoon thing, then it's like, yeah, totally. That makes complete sense within the framework of the book. And just as a side note, I thought when you're writing fantasy, and the reason I like it so much is that you can create new and exciting and different ways of doing drama, of telling stories, you know, the spoon drama. It's a new way to have a drama. And I just think that's just fun, it's exciting, it's unusual, and it's a little bit original, I hope.
Yes, no, but I absolutely agree that it all fits together, and it's logical, it's internally logical, and as a reader, I absolutely buy it. But I also sort of I'm fascinated by all these ideas that they feel. If you start thinking about them individually, it starts to. I sort of wonder why that. How did he come up with that for this? But yeah, no, I. It's one of the things that I really enjoy reading your books, because there are so many interesting and still logical ideas. So, and this sort of connects to another point, I mean, about this internal consistency and how the people in the book, in that world, they just live in their normal world, right? Yeah. And in Constant Rabbit and in Shades of Grey as well, there's been some event some time ago, and in Constant Rabbit it's in living memory, and in Shades of Grey it's, well, very far back, so no one really knows what it was. But is that a conscious choice you've made to write some time after the event has happened, so that this is now the normal? We're not really thinking about things as being new, but this is the situation.
Yeah, no, it's a good point. I mean, because one could say that fantasy is just like you take the real world and then you change like two things. You change two things 100 years ago, and then you write about what it's like now, because everything's changed, everything's different. And I think that I kind of like the way that works. But it's also a question of the. In the books I write, the people who are in the books, and this is true of any fantasy novel and any science fiction novel or any book that is not, you know, sort of straight human drama, basically, the people in it don't know it's an unusual world. Like my character, Peter Knott, he doesn't know any different. There have always been rabbits there, you know, as far as he's concerned. The world is with rabbits. So it's a very ordinary world to him. This is very normal. This is not unusual at all. So if you see rabbits walking down the street, you would not even think to comment there are rabbits walking down the street because there was something bizarre going on. And it's the same with Shades of Grey, is that you take it as very normal. And so what I suppose you're trying to do as a fantasy writer is you're trying to make the very, very unusual look slightly mundane and ordinary, and take these things and make them very, very not uninteresting, but certainly ordinary, and then try and find that narrative within something that is actually totally ordinary for these characters. So to these characters within their book, it is essentially a book of human drama. It's only us on the outside with our special knowledge, see if it's fantasy or anything unusual. So to Thursday, to my characters, Eddie Russet in Shades of Grey, Charlie in Early Riser. To them, these are quite ordinary human drama stories and nothing unusual at all. But I think it's nice, you know, being on the outside and looking in. And because humans have now been, you know, listening to stories for a very, very long time, we have this ability to, you know, basically sort of say, okay, tell me the rule, and I'm going to buy into it, and I'm going to really enjoy this. And, you know, if you've been writing drama right up until now, and then somebody wrote, you know, a fantasy absurd book where there's something that couldn't possibly happen, then the reaction might be very, very different. You know, what are you doing? But at the moment, you know, the great thing about readers, and I think reading is as much an imaginative process of writing, sometimes more, because I'm only, you know, an author. We're just putting into the when we describe things with a few words, which is the best way to describe anything, and we're creating this sort of world. But we're really only just giving little hints at what it's like, and the characters and everything, and the readers, they do the rest, they do the hard work, you know, the imagination. So it's I couldn't write this sort of stuff if we didn't have people to read them, bizarrely.
It's sometimes a little frustrating when you read a science fiction or fantasy book and things are sort of presented as marvelous or, you know.
No, it doesn't work. Yeah. So my Star Wars book, you know, because we talk about this, you know, Jasper, why don't you do a Star Wars novelization? I go, oh, no, it would be about some plumbers on the Death Star. You know, and that's all it would be about. It's, can you imagine the complexity of doing the plumbing on the Death Star? You know, I mean, how? I mean, because yeah. If you're close to the center of the Death Star, you know, there'd be very little gravity. But then, you know, close to the edge, would be. How can you use the gravity somehow to actually, you know, self-feed it? And the sort of the climax of the story would be they're trying to sort of unblock drains while the Death Star is under attack. And they'd be saying, look, I think actually we're going to just all die. And they go, yeah, well, whatever. But, you know, we just have to get these drains under. And that would be my Star Wars novel. It really would. The mundanity, but there would be adventure, there would be excitement. And these plumbers would be, you know, heroes and doing wonderful things. But it is that mundanity. And I think, yeah, you're right. Science fiction books that say, look at this amazing thing you can do. You know, we're going to walk back to whatever. But to anyone in it, it's normal. Yeah.
Yes.
You know, it's like us, yes, isn't it? Mobile phones.
They're exactly.
But they're magic. They're amazing. They're amazing things. But they're totally normal.
Yeah. No. I mean, absolutely. Or even a, you know, stationary phone, which people don't use much anymore. If you have a novel from 200 years ago and they describe this amazing device which you can talk to people at a distance, let's see if I have any other. I'm not quite sure how we are for time, but I think we have some time left. So what do you read for fun yourself?
Ooh,
if I may.
Cool. What do I read for fun? One of the most annoying things about being a writer. I mean, there aren't many annoying things. I mean, having to write books is both annoying and fun at the same time, because they can be very difficult to get out sometimes, and they just don't work. You know, and you're two-thirds way through, complete rubbish, and nothing works. It looks like nonsense, and then it slowly, you know, you push through it, and it works. But the other thing I think is I have less time for reading, and that's a real shame. I enjoy doing other things. I enjoy photography. I enjoy all kinds of stuff. I've got two daughters who need quite a lot of attention. You know, they're 12 and they're 10. And I have a very elderly mother who obviously needs looking after. And all these things, they pack out your time. So I forced myself to go on a book club, and they would have read all kinds of interesting things like bullback and stuff like that, which I'm not hugely into. But when I find a book, I will devour it, I must say. But I'm a terrible one to put it on Wikipedia, really, losing myself there. And just a lot of sciencey stuff. But frankly, I do not read enough. No, you should read as an author. You should read all the time. I don't read the media now, and there's not enough time in the day. I was reading the last really, really exceptional read. I should mention, of course, that as an author, and I used to work in the film industry. I've been 20 years in the film industry now, as an author, and it's spoiled both. Medium, because when you're in the film industry, a bad movie is very much obviously a bad movie, because you can see the movie being made and it's terrible. And when you're an author, and I read the first like paragraph, and I go, oh no, this is terrible, I'm really in bad hands. And you literally just throw it out the window straight away, because you go, I know it's going to be terrible. It really is going to be terrible. But on the other hand, that being an author or having worked in a filmmaker as a filmmaker, when you read a good book or you see a good movie, it makes it shine with this much greater luster, I must say. So I'm very bad with books. I will literally read a chapter, and if I think it's terrible, it will go straight out the window. When I start watching a movie, I quite often watch it for 10 or 15 minutes, and I'm very rarely wrong. You know it's going to be bad, you know. But if there's something in it, if there's something happening, if even if the first 10 minutes is bad or the first chapter is bad, but there's some little fact or there's something being dropped in that got your attention, then you go, okay, I'm going to go for another chapter, another 10 minutes, and you slowly get drawn in. So you don't lose it totally. But the last really good book I read, which I loved and adored and was telling everyone, was True Grit by Charles Porter, which is, it's a Western. It isn't really a Western. It's a kind of love story, I think. But it was just so fantastically well written, both from the narrating point of view and the action in it, everything. It was made into a very good film, actually, by the Coen brothers, who's highly Steinfeld. And Hailee Steinfeld, I watch everything that she does now, because she was so good in that film, sadly, you know, she hasn't had the role. She's had a couple of roles, which have been sort of worth her talents, but, you know, difficult, it's hard, it's very hard, but she was tremendous in that film. And what do you see in the film? If you've seen the film and haven't read the book, the film is basically the book, they've just taken all the words in the film. They're almost identical. They didn't use the only thing part of the book. So anyway, that last really good book.
Yeah. Okay, I have read seen the film but not read the book, so I think I should, because yes. Then can I tell you what can we look forward to from you next? Oh. What are you working on now? Are you allowed to tell? That's maybe not.
So what I've been doing is when I start writing the Aerotale, which is a standalone, and it is a standalone. But when you create a bizarre world in which all these strange things happen, it's kind of rather. I can think. Well, one. And then another sequel. So in the first and next series, there were actually seven in this series. And I was writing another book called The Last Dragon Slayer, which is a kind of young adult, my take on the magic dragon thing. And that was a thing. There you go. And that was a standalone. And I thought, I could write another one. I did. So what I've ended up is a whole bunch of series, none of which have actually ended. So the book I'm writing now is Dragon Slayer 4. So I can put that to bed. Mm-hmm. Then I'm going to write my Shades of Grey. There's going to be another because he's always saying, when is going to be another Shades of Grey? And it's been going on so long now, about 10 years, I think. But it didn't sell well. It sold very poorly. So I'm going to be doing that, and then I'm going on to 13x8. And that will finish the series. So just in case I sort of, you know, shuffle off this awful foil. You know, the one thing that you can't level at me is that I didn't leave all the books unfinished. So I want to get those. And after that, I don't know, I'm always having ideas. So short stories. I've got another couple of novels actually on my hard drive that I wrote earlier and never published. So I won't be short of them for either.
So yeah, really looking forward to Shades of Grey sequel. And Thirsty Next sequel, and Dragon Slayer sequel. That's excellent.
DNA, so I call it, in the field, out of the print of the office.
Yeah. Mm. So I think that we are. I wonder if we should start letting the audience questions in. I can see some questions in the stream, or should we wait for Jan to come back? I'm quite sure of the procedure here. We do have some. Yes, here he is.
Ah. Here I am. Yes, there are some questions, but I think Jonas will put them on the screen.
I can't. All right, here we are. Yeah, I've got one there. I'm very fond of the two nursery rhyme books. Will there be more? I'm not sure, actually. It's kind of they're two standalone, and they did kind of work. Again, they're not massive sellers, but I do like Jack Pratt and Gary Medley. They don't have any kind of unfinished plot lines with them, so I could do, and I do have various ideas for one. It was going to be called The Last Great Tortoise Race, and it was about in Reading, where the books are set, there was going to be the tortoise versus the hare race, which happens every year, and everyone put their money on the tortoise, on the hare, and of course the tortoise always wins, and clearly there's a huge scam going on, and the big sort of crime syndicate are all interested in not trying to nobble the hare. So there's that, and there's all sorts of things going on, and I think maybe Pandora is getting married to Prometheus, so I could bring in some fables and Greek legends as well, and the usual sort of nonsense. I could do so, but there's no massive plan, although, never say never say never. Oh, right, so this is good. Nina, hello. Right, you're curious about the painting in the background. Is that a self-portrait with a rabbit? Here we go. Well, this is me, just here, this is me. And this is Harvey. Now, if you haven't seen the movie Harvey with James Stewart, Jimmy Stewart, this was made in, I'm trying to remember the name of the person who wrote it, playwright who wrote it. Can't remember her name. It was an amazing stage play, and it's about a man called Elwood P. Dowd, who's a kind of bit of a sort of slight misfit and a bit of a drinker, and he has this imaginary friend who is a 6 foot 4 3/4 inch rabbit called Harvey, and it's about his sister trying to have him committed so that she can marry off her own daughter and be sort of welcomed into this polite sort of genteel upper middle class American society of the 50s. It's a wonderful film. I mean, it's absolutely lovely. And there's this tremendous moment in it where Elwood P. Dowd brings out a painting of himself and puts it on the mantelpiece. And it's of him and Harvey. And I've always wanted a painting of me and Harvey. So if you watch the film, you will see that actually this will be Jimmy Stewart in the film. So this is me in the Jimmy Stewart role of Harvey, the film Harvey. If you haven't seen this film, you've got to see this film. It's so wonderful, it's so delightful. And Jimmy Stewart was just the most amazing actor, and that sort of laconic, that kind of stuff. That's what it is. That's what it is. It's my little sort of, my little Harvey thing. Okay, so Love Shades of Grey, and I'm hoping for a sequel. Yes, me too. Is it difficult to balance the absurdity with crafting a good plot and good character development? It's a really good question. I can just be super absurd all the time, but if the characters within the book aren't relatable, then it's all a kind of exercise in empty cleverness, I suppose you could say. The things that happen in the book, the absurd things that happen in the book, have to have relevance to the characters. Otherwise, you have this separation, right? So you've got your characters, and you've got your absurdity, and you've got a plot, and all that kind of stuff, and they have to be together, like this. And if all of a sudden the absurdity is taking over, and your characters are like sort of hanging on to the tail of the tiger, if you like, then all of a sudden things start fracturing and separating out. So often when I'm writing a book and I'm sort of thinking, this is great, and I love this idea, the spoon idea, where can we go with this? How can we merge it somehow into the plot and make it, part of the plot and part of something the characters deal with, I sort of throw it away and I don't use it, or I use it later. So it's very important that the complexities of the plot and the absurdities do make sense for the character, and they have a sort of payoff as well. And this is also, I think, something that's quite important. There's a sort of subplot. I'm not trying not to give too much away. There's a subplot in The Constant Rabbit about duels, and I like this idea of rabbits fighting duels with pistols. You know, pistols at dawn to sort things out. And there's a sort of ongoing subplot with you know, dueling rabbits that is actually paid off at the end in quite a nice little way. And it's taking things and actually making them part of the plot that I think is really important. Another just a side note also about character is you can either explain a character. There's two real ways of making a character kind of work. And one is that you explain the character, right? And I think this is very, very bad. Some people can do it really well, and they explain what the character is and how they react and do it. So what I like to do is I have a character and then something happens and you understand their character based on how they react to something that's happening, right? So if something bizarre happens and they react in one way, and they react another way, you know, it's a testing time for characters. You know, you don't know how you're going to react in a panic or an emergency until a panic or emergency happens. So sometimes with my books, I bring them in. My character is Thursday Next in the Thursday Next series. She's sort of a kind of normal cop, if you like, but then something unusual happens, and it's how she reacts to that that kind of defines her character. So in many cases, and just in like in Shades of Grey and also in Constant Rabbit, the characters are quite ordinary. You know, Peter Knox is quite an ordinary character who then has to deal with sort of extraordinary things. And it's really how he reacts to that, that kind of defines his character and makes his character. So I go from that point of view, is that you take someone quite normal and then you put them in a situation and then something rather odd happens. And it's, what do? Do they run away? Do they deny it? You know, or do they embrace it? Or do they learn by it? And that is character defining. Right. So from Malin, which one is your favorite of all your beasts in the books? Mine is the adjectivore and the three pigs. Yes, the because we all think the three pigs are victims, but of course they're not. They're just horrible individuals. The adjectivores, they are a parasitic life form that live inside books. So they're called gramicites. And adjectivores will actually take all the adjectives out of a sentence. So a blue door would just become a door, which is very annoying, really, if you're trying to write a decent book. I have all sorts of characters that I really like. There's the Gronk from Early Riser. I really like this idea of the Gronk, who's a kind of he's a winter Volk. He's one of the bizarre creatures that live in the winter, and he's sort of based on the Grok from the Moomins. So I do like the Gronk quite a lot. And there was Melanie Bradshaw, who's married to Commander Bradshaw, who's actually a gorilla, who's a very sort of nice, sensitive kind of character who I rather like. There's all sorts of little, you know, ancillary characters that I like a great deal. I think there was Cindy, is it? I think, who's married to Spike in the Thursday Next books. And he stakes vampires and kills werewolves for a living. And she's actually a hitwoman for the mob. And she can't bring herself to tell him what she does, because she thinks that maybe he'll leave her. And he's exactly the same with her. So you have this odd little thing going on between them that's so sweet and romantic, you know. So yeah, I do like ancillary characters that you can just do a small amount with. You know, I think also there's Gretel in the Nursery Crime series, and she's very, very tall. And she meets someone else who is equally tall, and as a first date they decide to go and look at the baby giraffe in the zoo, which I thought was quite sweet, a bit of romantic kind of interlude. So the thing is, if you're writing, and I'm sure the people out there who are writing, your ancillary characters, give them a little something to play with, throw them a bone, make them just something that defines them, and it just lifts everything, you know, just lifts the whole thing. Good. Can we look forward to any screen or stage adaptations of your book, and that's from Jan. I had my last Dragon Slayer book turned into a TV show, and whilst it was, I'm in two minds about it. I'll be diplomatic. I'm in two minds about it. I think the interesting thing about film rights, of course, is that once it's gone, it's gone. It's like you're selling your house. And when you sell your house, you can't go around to the people who bought it and say, listen, I think you should don't paint the door a different color, you know, keep the curtains, and you know, you really shouldn't move furniture around. It's gone. So all you can do is when someone wants to buy a property, a book property, you know, to make into a film, is the real choice you have is yes or no. That's it. There's no more. Once it's gone, it's gone. They can do what they want with it, basically. So you have to choose very carefully. So whenever I am talking to a producer calls me and says, you know, let's have a talk, and I speak to them and I think, are you capable of doing this? Will you do this justice? Do you understand the book? Are you going to go forward to this and do it the best you can? And most of the time the answer is no, you have no idea what you're talking about. You've just seen a book and someone sent you a pricey of it and now you're trying to buy it. And that's commodity brokerage. It's not, you know, making a book into a TV, and the chance that it's going to do badly is probably quite high. So I prefer to say no than see it made badly, to be honest. I think it's a shame. But anyway, but also when I speak to a producer, I have these two rules. Right, two rules. That looks like a bunny, doesn't it? Two rules is that they have to have made something I've heard of, right? Have to have made something I've heard of. And the other rule is I had to have liked it. And that's kind of a bit of a tall order sometimes, because you get producers who've got tons of credits and you go, I've never heard of any of these films. You know, they just vanish without trace. The producer on The Last Dragon Slayer, he came over to me and he rang me up and he said, I'm producer. And I said, oh, what have you done? And he said, I produced In Bruges, right? The film In Bruges, which is again, another very, very good film that I wholly recommend you should see. In Bruges, it's a lovely film. It's about the complexities of redemption, the immense complexity of redemption and friendship. And it's well worth a view. And he was a producer on it, and I love the film. So I said yes to The Last Dragon Slayer. And we were hoping for a movie, but in the end, it was a TV show. But hey ho, there you go.
Yeah, well, this is about all the time we have today. I would really like to thank Jasper for joining us. It's been an amazing journey to listen to you today. And thank you, Linnéa, for all the insightful questions. There are copies of the concept in both shops. Sorry? Yes. And so we have copies in stock. And the form for getting a copy signed is still up, so and will be up. So take the opportunity to get a signed personalized copy of the book from Jasper. The next thing up in our marathon today, in about 20 minutes, is Lev Grossman, author of Magicians, among other things, joining us from his home in New York, talking to Sara Bergmark Elfgren, who wrote the for instance, she's a great writer in her own right. Before that, I would like for all of you to click the link in the chat and join us in the Mingle Room, where we can chat, the Coffee Clutch Room, where we can chat with Jasper and if we have further questions. So again, thank you very much, Linnéa. Thank you very much, Jasper, for joining us today and taking time out of your busy schedule. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.